Thanks, Lauren. Okay, so I am very excited to be able to share some of the opportunities specific to consumer health informatics with all of you today. I am going to start with a question, and the question is this. Does anybody know, who can tell me what is in this image that is sitting in front of that very modern television? Does anybody recognize that? It's a computer. That's right. It's a computer. So this is one of the very first sort of home computers, way before Apple's, way before Commodore 64's, all these. My father bought this when I was in fifth grade, which was in 1981, and I'm not going to ask if any of you were alive in that year because obvious reasons. So I was super excited. Fifth grade kid, got this computer, wrote a program called Future Teacher. Who knew? And took it to enter in our school science fair, 1981, fifth grade. So here's an easier question. What place do you think I came in our science fair in 1981 entering a computer program? Dead last. The whole science fair. And the reason was because the consensus of the entire panel of judges was that there would never be a role for computers in education, right? And so there's a lot of lessons there, right? I got some of those. I hope some of them apply to you as well. And one of those was shared by a teacher and a mentor. So even going back to fifth grade, I kind of got what the role of a mentor could be, how useful, how invaluable partnering with a mentor could be. And she shared this quote with me, that it will ever come into general use is extremely doubtful. And that had been written about this high-tech thing called a stethoscope. So again, a lot of takeaways there. Timing's important. But really, the thing that I hope you guys take away the most is the fact that if you have a vision for something, if you anticipate something, and you have a rationale for it, then don't let sort of easy doubt or doubters try to sway you. Go ahead and again, as long as it's something you have a rationale for, stick with it. Stay true to whatever course or path you think that is for you. All right, so four things that I hope we accomplish during this session. The first is we're just going to introduce some basic terminology in and around consumer health informatics and digital health. We're going to explore the digital landscape in and around pharmacy. We're going to talk about sort of reflecting, or maybe for you, self-reflecting, right, on positive characteristics associated with digital health career-wise, and then we'll look at a handful of successful pharmacists who are in this digital health space. So here's my definition. It's technically not mine. It's ARCS, but the emphasis there is mine. But really, so you see it, it's tools and technologies used for the patient, et cetera. But the piece that I pulled out, right, is the with or without the presence of a healthcare professional. And that's, to me, what really separates, in a lot of ways, consumer health informatics from many of the other specialties within informatics. Informatics is just sort of information, people, technology, and then you go into the various biomedical health, et cetera. But here, you can kind of functionally think of consumer health informatics as being a bit more patient-facing. A lot of it is outpatient versus probably what you're familiar with, electronic health records, et cetera, being a little bit more inpatient. That's a kind of simplified, but really that's the big takeaway. Now, during the rest of the session today, I'm actually going to be referring to consumer health informatics as digital health instead of consumer health informatics. And the reason for that is it's a term that's being more broadly used. And so since we're talking about careers and career paths and opportunities, much of the time those opportunities would be termed in and around digital health. I actually just met someone here at USB who was describing their work in their working group or their group. And again, digital health is the term that's being used to describe this. So the other thing I wanted to do is share another perspective, right? So this is from a pharmaceutical industry perspective on what digital health means. I borrowed it from a colleague of mine with permission. And so you see kind of going clockwise, starting at the top, mHealth, mobile health, and connection tools, mobile devices. Digital diagnostics, EHRs, at least where it connects with the outpatient. Sensors, wearables, connected health, social media, which may surprise you, that sort of intersection of social media and healthcare, and big data, right? So this is how they sort of functionally think about digital health. I'm going to go through a sampler platter of four items that are pharmacy specific within digital health. The first one is here depicted called by AdhereTech. And a lot of what I see that's successful so far within digital health uses some sort of bridge technology. And that's just a term used to describe, you start with something that's familiar, maybe low tech or analog, and then you sort of use that familiarity to reduce that learning curve to bridge over to the digital version. So AdhereTech looks broadly like a prescription vial you might be familiar with, right? But the difference is when it's time for a patient to take their medication, that little ribbon of light lights up. And if that doesn't prompt action, and action is defined here as it detects when the cap is open and measures how many tablets comes out, then it goes to the next stage. So you think, well, if you don't see it, it's not going to work. True. So the next step is a gentle little chime. And if that doesn't prompt action, the next one is an annoying buzz. And if that doesn't work, it will text you. And if that doesn't work, it will call you. And if that doesn't work, it will call your mama, right? And so I say that sort of tongue-in-cheek, but probably the more likely version of that is an adult taking care of their adult parents and a caregiver. So this can transmit that information to the patient as well as some a pharmacist or a designated caregiver, right? So the next one is called Proteus, and we have a consumer health informatics course at Lipscomb University, and one of the sessions that we have is new technology, is this cool or creepy? So I'm going to briefly describe it and then just a little calisthenics, ask you guys what your take on it. So this is a smart pill system. So the large thing that kind of looks like a Band-Aid is a patch, right? But the system itself is predicated on this edible biosensor that is attached to a tablet or now in a capsule. Patient takes the medication and it transmits from via Bluetooth to the patch, then to the phone, provider's phone, caregiver's phone, if it's configured as such. So again, it sends information that confirms the medication has been taken, as well as some baseline physiological information, maybe a bit of activity and movement. So is that cool? Is that creepy? So we'll start with cool. Creepy. A little of both. Yeah. So think about it, right? So one of the things that we have to do around informatics is figure out some of these ethical questions, societal questions. What are the implications of this? What if an insurance company says, well, we're no longer going to be able to pay for or reimburse or provide any financial incentive around you taking this medication, you're going to have to pay everything out of pocket because we say that you've fallen below the barrier of 70% adherence. There's some issues that have to be worked through there, right? Okay. But again, the way it works now with both of these items, in particular, the first one is they all get routed through the pharmacy. So with AdhereTech, the pharmacist would help with the patient at point of dispensing configure how they want the reminders, which different reminders are involved. Proteus right now in a lot of different pilots is using compounding pharmacies to insert the sensor into capsules prior to its use. Next is Glucase. And so this is a little bit different. It's a different type of adherence, more about testing, right? So basically what they've done is taken a phone case and put everything that a patient with type 1 diabetes would need for testing. So if you press here, the strips come out. If you press up here, Lancet comes out. The wireless glucometer is down below the silver part there. So everything is all in one contained, right? So you can see from a barrier to adherence that the types of benefits that would confer. You can see as well, for especially if you're talking about a teen with type 1 diabetes, in some cases a bit of the stigma can be ameliorated with that type of tool. And then lastly here is Propeller Health, used to be as Mapalus, and so in this particular case, a tiny piece goes on the top of the inhaler, and every time it's depressed, It registers as a use, which ties to adherence. But it's not limited to only that. Some of the coolest things that this particular platform can do are not directly tied to adherence. It's a bit more public health, right? So for example, every time it's used, it also has geolocation data tied to it. So where it's used, coordinates, right? Where it's being used. So as more people use it, they basically can map out areas, geographical areas tied to asthma exacerbation based on the data this is producing. So you can start to see maybe some of the utility and potential there. So Apple HealthKit, has anybody heard of Apple HealthKit? Okay, you will if you haven't. Apple HealthKit, Apple ResearchKit is basically, in this, for our purposes, it's middleware. It's not hardware, software, middleware. And it is a tool that will take information that's patient-generated, wearables, apps, devices, sensors, bring it through all the way into the electronic health record, which is kind of a holy grail people have been looking for a while. So again, a full ecosystem of information. To my knowledge, the first case where that's been done has been published. It was in pediatrics with type 1 diabetes at Stanford Children's. So it's just starting, but it is out there. If you look at these names and institutions, the EHR companies, the insurers, this is something someone who's more cynical than I am, but also who is smarter than I am, said follow the money when you look at things. And so when you look at institutional investment in technologies and approaches, that's where you're going to see some of this lead to these types of things. I mentioned social media. One of the things is pharmacovigilance, right? So what current federal national system do we use largely to try to detect and record adverse events? Thank you, MedWatch. Great system in theory. The challenge with it is the last stats I've seen are about maybe estimates are that 1 to 10% of adverse events actually get into the system. So if you think about social media, chances are you've heard someone talk about if they feel good, talk about their medication, talk about if they're sick, talk about a number of things. So all those conversations can be mined and used as an early warning system about adverse events, about a number of things in and around medication use. Some of our students are even doing a project right now where they're mining images and metadata from Instagram around medication use. So again, think of opportunities that you're interested in. Chances are you have some faculty or other pharmacists who would be working on something along those lines. This is something that's quite new. This is a virtual reality headset. Virtual reality is not new. The healthcare applications are increasingly so. This is basically a headline, right? So you see, in this particular case, the child had fear and anxiety and pain in and around an infusion. So they used the virtual reality to create an immersive environment for him to help address all those things, which has been used successfully at a number of institutions. It's virtual reality has also been used in similar ways for desensitization therapy around phobias, a little bit around autism and some other indications so far. The other thing that I really want to point out about this, we have a VR virtual reality exercise at Lipscomb where we issue a virtual reality headset to every student in the class. And for the deans in the room, I want to point out the fact that we did select Google Cardboard. And if you're not aware, Google Cardboard's $15 for the VR device. So, and you think about those types of things. I don't have a particularly savvy business mind, but I do recognize you have to be able to scale. And so if you start with a $15 device versus a $499 device, you have a better chance, right? Who's heard of blockchain? Who's heard of Bitcoin? Crypto? Wow. Gracious. Okay. So blockchain is the underlying technology that powers Bitcoin. And it is just now, really in the last year or so, being looked at applications to healthcare. It's a deep subject, but some of our students, for example, are already looking at how can we use potentially blockchain technology to combat counterfeit medications by securing the supply chain. So tuck this in your head. You'll hear much more about this in the coming years. All right, so that's a bit about the arena. my sort of advice to you, how do you seek this if you're interested? First, right there, right? Choose a more interesting environment. If you're interested in digital health, consumer health, informatics, there's not typically a very straightforward, linear-only path to get you there. You're going to have to seek out things. You're going to have to look at taking different paths. It's generally not a terrible idea anyway, but it's particularly necessary in this particular sphere. Anybody heard of Verily? So Verily used to be Google Life Sciences, which I imagine many of you have heard of, right? So if you're looking for jobs, most of the normal places you're going to check in pharmacy specific, or if you're going to branch out to a LinkedIn and Indeed.com, et cetera. But when you're doing those searches, whether it's LinkedIn, whether it's Indeed, don't limit yourself to only very pharmacist-sounding jobs, which might seem counterintuitive, but the next job that you're qualified for or the next position that you might create might come through this unconventional type of search. So in this particular case, this is what they were looking for. Someone to work on projects like smart contact lenses with miniaturized glucose sensors. It's kind of cool, right? There's another one that actually the contact dispenses the medication. So what are the qualifications? What are they looking for? Well, doctoral level degree, like a PharmD, and working with health-related databases, EHRs, predictive analytics, which is, of course, that Dr. Breeden added to the master's program, disease management, which all of you will get in pharmacy school. And then you see the last one, publishing at conferences, peer-reviewed medical journals, etc. Think of all of your faculty are doing these types of things, which means there's opportunity for you guys to do all of these types of things. You just have to seek them out. This is from the World Economic Forum at Davos. Davos is the big annual meeting that you may or may not have heard of. If you haven't, you're typically a multimillionaire or above to attend. These are the people that in some ways are creating jobs and making decisions about job creation. And these are the top 10 skills that they said that you would need to thrive in the workplace in 2020. Two takeaways. One, a third of these have changed just since 2015. Right? And secondly, creativity, as you saw or see, went from 10th to 3rd. So if you're looking at these, if you see a bit of yourself in these, digital health and pharmacy, consumer health informatics may be for you. Certainly you can take a more conventional approach. These are all companies that you're probably familiar with and to a certain extent. They all have a digital health presence. The two at the top have a really expanding digital health units within them. So these are fertile grounds if you're interested in positions. The last items here are basically the successful digital health pharmacists I meant. This particular one is a pharmacist doing fantastic work with everything from design thinking to using 3D printing specific to pharmacy. His site is there. Dr. Angst is another very much a rising star in and around this area with digital pharmacy. Kelly is our neighbor to the north. She's one of the leading folks in pharmacy looking at digital health technology, particularly in the older or elderly population. That one's not terrible. PillPack. Okay, if nothing else makes you raise your eyebrow or however you express it, excitement, this T.J. Parker graduated less than 5 years ago. I met him at a mobile health conference. There was less than half a dozen pharmacists at this conference. This guy had gotten an internship with a digital health company. From that point in time until now, so far, he's had raised $60 million in capital for his company. Graduated less than 5 years ago. PharmD. And this is the site for Benoit. Benoit is a PharmD who is in charge of a digital health division at Withings, which makes a lot of different types of digital health equipment. Right, so these are all sort of example paths of people who have done things in and around this area. I appreciate your time and attention, and you can contact me here or after. Thank you.